Hi, I'm Peter Ashley. Welcome to another episode of Mendoza Dialogues. We're here today actually in Chicago at Notre Dame's campus on 224 South Michigan Avenue. So it's exciting to be at another facility of Notre Dame's right near where our guest works. And we're very excited to have a special guest. With us today is Crane Kenney, who is the president of business operations for none other than the Chicago Cubs. Crane, thanks for coming.
Happy to be here.
Obviously, there's a lot of fun things to talk about today. Before we get into the specifics of the Cubs World Series and everything else, I want to hear a little bit more about you and your career path and what got you to the Cubs.
Sure. And it's interesting because I get a lot of calls from students who say, I'd like to run a professional team. How did you get there? And back in my day, we didn't have grandiose plans when we were in college. My plan was to graduate, and I did from Notre Dame in 1985, and then I went to law school thinking I would be a lawyer. And then graduating from Michigan Law School, went to practice law, and happily found myself doing work for media entities and the Chicago Bears. The Bears were one of our clients for the firm I worked for at Schiff, Hardin & Waite, and really enjoyed working in sports. It had always been a passion of mine, and found that type of work the kind that I liked to do best. And then ultimately left there and went to Tribune Company, which is a big media conglomerate owning newspapers, television stations, radio stations, digital businesses. They also happen to own the Cubs. I didn't go there for the Cubs. I went there for the media work. Mm-hmm. But it happened to be that I did a lot of work for the Cubs as a lawyer, and did that from 1994 until 2003. And then they put the Cubs under me as a business operation in 2003, and I started running the team then.
Great. It's been quite a ride, I'm sure.
It's been a great ride. Yeah, been a great ride through several owners and a bankruptcy and a couple of other interesting chapters.
Yeah. And they have not only survived, but obviously thrived.
Yeah. The business is now thriving. It was not always that way.
So can you elaborate a little bit on revenue models for professional sports teams and specifically the Cubs?
Sure.
Given the changing, you know, dynamics around sports and appetite for sports, how does that work?
Yeah, so I think, and there's plenty of media coverage of the value of our media rights. So live sports are one of the genres of programming that are really desirable. I think in a world with 500 channels, you see a lot of things that are captured and then people are binge watching or watching later and eliminating commercials. And the engaged fan who stays with a program in real time is becoming a thing of the past, with a couple of exceptions: news, which is timely, and sports, because once you know the outcome of a game, it becomes less interesting. So we really hold an audience for live events like sports, and what I call them, rather than call them just sports, is it's basically unscripted drama, right? We don't know how it's going to end. You need to be there for the whole story to really understand it, and so sports has occupied a really valuable place in the sort of in the media landscape. And so I would say the primary revenue driver for our business is our media rights, so radio, television, and digital. And then the second big driver is our gate, obviously attracting as many fans as we can. Very fortunate to have Wrigley Field as our home venue, which in addition to playing baseball there, it's also this great historic archive. And people do come to see Wrigley Field as part of the bucket list. As we say, if you need to understand the national pastime, you probably need to visit Cooperstown, and you might want to visit Fenway, but you need to also visit Wrigley Field. We're the second oldest ballpark in baseball. So we have a great venue, and so our gate receipts. And then after that, it's sponsorship revenue, letting partners put their brand together with ours and try and create some magic, and then concessions and parking and everything else. But it's the whole bowl that really makes the thing work. And we've been on a mission to turn this business around for the last, say, 6-7 years. And each one of those revenue lines has been very important to us.
So what makes the Cubs, or what differentiates the Cubs, would you say, besides just winning the World Series, but from other baseball teams?
Well, a number of things. I mean, so one, we have a lot of great tailwinds. Today we have tailwinds. They weren't always this way, but to begin with, we play in a great market. So Chicago is the third largest market in the country, and one that's passionate about its sports. Very fortunate to play here. I think there's other towns where, for instance, Tampa, they played really good baseball for many years, but they can't generate the same enthusiasm around the club as we can. So great market. The history of the game in Chicago. So we're one of the original 8 founding members of the National League. We're the only team to play consistently in the same city of all 8 of those teams. We date our origins back to 1876. So there is a very deeply embedded culture of baseball in Chicago and with the Cubs. We're also fortunate that WGN took our games outside the market in the early 80s. And so for many years in markets like Colorado before they got baseball, Arizona before they got baseball, Florida, and we go on, and markets that don't have baseball yet today, they were fed Cub games growing up. We also played the predominance of our games until 1988, we played during the day. So for a lot of folks, coming home from school meant coming home from school, turning on WGN, the superstation, and watching the Cubs. So we created a national fan base, largely because of Harry Carey and Wrigley Field and the fact that GN was carrying us into 70 million homes outside Chicago, whereas most teams are regional in nature. So you know, if you're a Reds fan, you probably grew up around Cincinnati. We have Cub fans all over the country in Puerto Rico. And so when we map our attendance each year and we learn as much as we can about our fans, we'll see that all 50 states and usually another dozen or so countries are represented in the ballpark. So that makes us a little different. So size of the market, deeply embedded fan base, the WGN factor that brought us outside the market. And then there's something about Wrigley that's just, it's appealing to people. It's one of those old ballparks. It's very quaint. Everyone is really close to the field. So a modern ballpark today is probably built on 15 acres. We're on less than six. So, you know, if you're at Wrigley, you're probably in a place where you're closer to the game than you've ever been. Hopefully it's a nice day, not always in Chicago. And then Wrigleyville is this kind of interesting animal. It's an entertainment district, lots of bars, lots of live music. Some beginning to see some pretty good restaurants, but it's lakefront, very close to the city, easy to get to. Parking's a little difficult, but that means most people walk, bike, ride, or take the L to the ballpark. So we have this cool environment, a really cool ballpark inside it, and then those other factors that we think give us a little bit of a different business model.
Interesting. And now we talked before the show that I've not historically been a huge baseball fan,
right.
But obviously, like many others, became a huge baseball fan and watched with rapt attention the World Series. My father-in-law was actually a White Sox fan, but he was pulling
right.
for the Cubs.
Right.
So just other than the kind of obvious, you know, exhilaration, to talk a little bit about that experience of how the season went, getting into the World Series, that incredibly exciting finish, just
yeah.
from your perspective.
So I have 20 years of this thing, so it's the capstone of a mission. In some ways, it's a business issue for us, though, because we were so well defined by our futility, right? In some ways, I like to say a crisis is a terrible thing to waste, right? Because a crisis can galvanize you around a mandate, can galvanize you around an agenda. And our agenda for all these years has been, we have to be the team that solves the riddle, right? Mm-hmm. For 108 years, we've had teams come and go, great teams in many cases come and go, and haven't been able to win the World Series. And so you start asking yourselves why, and you pull the business apart. Is there something we can do on the business side that gives us an advantage, whether it's more resources to put on the field in terms of payroll, better facilities? Is there something we can do about training our players, rehabbing our players? So everyone has a role, and what's been, I say it's a blessing and a curse. You know, the blessing of this drought is if you walked into our organization from any other prior organization, you knew on day one what our mission was. And you were reminded every day by our fans, right? By the cab driver, by the person at the dry cleaners, anybody you ran into, they would say, is this the year? Is this the year? And you were reminded by the late night comedians who used this as a punchline, right? So we wore that persona as a motivation. Mm-hmm. And so leading up to the World Series, we really focused on this as being the season that potentially could get us there. And just to be very clear, the reason we won the World Series is we had the best athletes. Mm-hmm. There's no question. Everything we do on the business side, everything that's done throughout the organization, with the exception of what goes on the field, is just ancillary. Mm-hmm. We won the World Series because we had the best players. And they played together, and the culture was right, and largely created by our manager. So that's why we won. But leading up to it, it was interesting. We were the best team throughout the regular season. We won 103 games. We were in the best season coming out of spring training. But the best team doesn't always win. The randomness of baseball and these short series that you play, especially the first round, which is a five-game series, almost every year we'll look back and say, we don't think the best team won, because baseball is a random sport. The best team doesn't win every day, and certainly when you play a five-game series, the team that wins three games out of those five, not always the best team. We were very fortunate to get out of the San Francisco series. We were actually planning on playing game five. We were down in game four and looked at the prospects of facing one of their best pitchers, Johnny Cueto, back here in an all or nothing game in Chicago, which I'm sure would have caused a lot of people to have heart palpitations. And we came back in the ninth inning in a dramatic win there. So very fortunate to get out of San Francisco. We then played the Dodgers. We were down 2-1 in that series, so certainly didn't steamroll the Dodgers in any way. Had Clayton Kershaw to face twice coming out of that, and somehow found a way through in six games to beat the Dodgers. And then we're down 3-1 in the Cleveland series. Mm-hmm. So certainly being down 3-1, you don't feel that confident, but our pitching did line up for us. After Hendricks did his thing and Lester did his thing, you know, we had Jake Arrieta going in Cleveland again, and then Hendricks. So we were lined up with the right pitching. Game seven was epic because we had a big lead. We gave the lead back. There was a rain delay, and then obviously we prevailed in the end. So in many ways, the World Series, I think the best team did win. Mm-hmm. You know, we could say with some humility, but the record would probably tell you we were the best team during the season. And then we won the World Series in a dramatic way. So just kind of like the perfect ending for Cub fans.
So when you were 3-1, was there anyone feeling kind of resigned that, well, another year we're not going to win? Or was everyone saying, you know what, we can still win this, we're going to win it?
Well, so the randomness of baseball tells you you're never really done. Mm-hmm. And there's been plenty of cases of teams, you know, coming back from, not during the World Series, but in other series, right, where you're down 3-1 and you can come back. So we did like the way the pitching lined up going into those final three games. So I don't think anyone was resigned. I was happy to get back to Cleveland because I didn't want to lose at home. Mm. You know, so we had a real epic game five that we nursed a lead. John Lester did an amazing job to get us into game six. And I just didn't, actually, here's a Notre Dame connection. I had these visions of Boston College when they beat us at home and we were ranked number one. And the Boston College players took souvenirs, if you remember, from the field. Mm-hmm. They took some of our turf home with them. And I had this image in my head, if we lost game five, of Cleveland fans celebrating by taking some ivy off of our walls.
Right.
And it would have been probably appropriate. I mean, it wouldn't have been that. It wouldn't have been vandalism.
Well, it's free landscaping.
It's free landscaping. But I had this image of like, boy, if we lose today, I could see that happen. It would bring back a lot of bad memories from my Notre Dame time. But I certainly just don't want to see that happen in front of our fans. Mm-hmm. So getting to game six was really big for us. And then obviously had a real, Jake had a huge start for us in game six. So we actually went from being concerned, very concerned, down 3-1. After Jake won game six, I think we had a lot of confidence going into game seven with Kyle starting game seven for us.
That's great. And so we talk a lot about, you know, business school, obviously, strategy.
Yep.
And you mentioned kind of navigating the last 15 years. Talk to us if you have any specific strategic decision that you look back on and say that was an extremely important decision that we made that led to these outcomes, or just a series of decisions that might have affected the development of the team.
Yeah. Well, there have been a lot. And I would say in our game, in this, you know, I'm on the business side. Theo Epstein is my partner on the baseball side, and he would probably say the same things. This success, or to the extent we've had success, it's really a million small decisions that we make every day that make a difference. It's the scouts that go a little further to see a kid pitch in junior college or high school and then file a report that ultimately leads to him being drafted. It's our trainer spending more time with our players to rehab them from an injury. It's the video team spending more time breaking down another club to give us an advantage as we go in to face that team. On my side, it might be our ticket department deciding, you know, that we're going to eliminate some season ticket holders who were brokers, who were selling our tickets in the secondary market and depressing the price of our primary market. It's our media rights team. We haven't signed on to a new media rights agreement because we think the future is going to be brighter than the present.
So along the lines of decisions, we talked all with a previous guest around crisis communications and during a hurricane and
right.
Significant decisions and leadership during that time. But there's the flip side of when there's a big success, especially when there's years of, as you said, futility, what are the challenges that are created by having to lead through success?
Yeah. I actually think it's easier to lead during a time of crisis. I think you have everyone's attention, for sure. And whether it's a recession, and I was actually just speaking to a group of bankers about what you learned about yourself during the last recession, and what you learned about your team and their ability during the recession, and what you learned about your customers and your business model, everything. I mean, you get a very sober view of the character of your team and the strength of your business during trying times. And I would say the crises that we've gone through brought our team together in a really strong way. I'm kind of not a believer in crises, but if there is a crisis, you make the most of it. It probably will cause you to make hard decisions. And maybe there's a business line that you probably should have jettisoned, or maybe there's a staff member that needs to change their performance. And in good times, it might mask those things. In tougher times, they become more obvious and you need to start making hard decisions. So that's that on crisis. On the success side, I think success brings some real issues for us. And we're maybe unique in this case because, as I mentioned earlier, the 108 years of futility created this really strong mandate around what we were trying to do. And if you interviewed anyone in our organization, from the folks who worked taking your tickets to the CEO, to me, or to our ownership and said, so what's the number one goal for the Cubs? Win a World Series, right? And so everyone would say that. And so every decision is looked through a prism of, is this getting us closer to a World Series? So whether it's rebuilding our facilities in Arizona or rebuilding our facilities in the Dominican Republic or changing our media partners in Chicago or drafting this kid versus that kid, the question was always, you know, does that get us closer? Is that an investment we should make for the one goal we all know we have? So now we've achieved our goal. And what concerns me about it is, you know, I talk to fans a lot, and we just had our Cubs convention, and when I say to our fans, what are your expectations or hopes for 2017? Too many of them have said, you know, I really don't care. I'm still enjoying the moment of winning. And I'm going to celebrate the 2016 World Series for the next year.
For 108 years.
For the next year, right. Or maybe for the next several years. And I guess I'm just not that invested in what happens immediately next year. And I think that's really dangerous. I don't think that's the way our people inside the organization feel. I know the baseball operations group doesn't feel that way. But it is, you know, success can breed, you know, it can breed arrogance. I think it can breed complacency. Mm-hmm. If you have too much success, you know, too many people begin looking for credit. And so I do worry, and because in our case it was so dramatic and so sought after.
Mm-hmm. And so clear.
And so clear, you know, our game is different. You know, I guess the stock market will tell you in some ways which organizations are doing well and which ones aren't, but that's only a small indicator. In ours, it's like your win-loss record. And you could be an organization completely bankrupt of character or morality or integrity and still win a World Series, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because it's really the 25 guys on the field that win the World Series. The organization may not be that something you'd want to emulate. We want to be both. So our saying is we want to be the best team on and off the field. And so I would say success for me, since we haven't enjoyed it very much, you know, this is our first time really saying that we're a true success given what's happened on the field. I'm not sure how we'll handle it, and I'm nervous about it. And we've been talking openly in our organization about, I think people will look to see how we wear the crown. And I think there's some really good examples of organizations that have won championships and continued to succeed. Locally, the Blackhawks. With 3 Stanley Cups. You got to be very proud of an organization that can do it more than once. I think in basketball, we look at the San Antonio Spurs because they not only win, but they win the right way with the right types of players, and they do the right things as an organization in their city. So we're looking at a couple of organizations to see why and how they've done it, and we just hope we can follow their lead.
That's great. You mentioned Wrigley, so I wanted to ask a little bit more about the renovations that are going on in general in the neighborhood and in the facility. Can you share a little bit more about what's happening there now?
Yeah, so As I mentioned earlier, we're really fortunate to play A in Chicago and B in Wrigleyville, which has, you know, if you really look back, we're in some ways we're just lucky that Wrigley was this accidental relic. Because in the 80s, 70s and 80s, when these older ballparks, you know, Tiger Stadium, Forbes Field, you go through the league, they were all destroyed and replaced with what we call ball malls, right? Unobstructed view, wide concourse, much bigger footprint, lots of concessions, easy parking. And so when all the ballparks, except for Fenway, really Dodger Stadium, Fenway, and Wrigley, as they were all being replaced, for whatever reason, through the those of that era, Wrigley remained. And unfortunately, it remained without a lot of capital investment, but it did remain. And so really what the Ricketts family, our new owners, inherited was this amazing old ballpark, in some ways a museum, that had undergone maybe 25 years of deferred maintenance. So we had concrete falling from the upper deck, which was being caught by nets. Mm-hmm. So our fans were protected by nets. Restrooms that largely didn't work, concessions that were behind the times. And all sorts of other things.
But some people probably love it for that same reason, right?
Well, there are fans who enjoy, who don't want any change. Mm-hmm. You know, the mandate, if you ask our fans, they'd say, absolutely, you're right. The number one thing is win a championship. The second thing is don't change anything at Wrigley. The third is don't raise ticket prices. And basically, don't change. Mm-hmm. So that's been one of the conversations we've been having for me, in my case, for 10 years, 13 years with our fans, which is change is okay. You know, playing concerts in our ballpark actually help us get closer to a World Series, mm-hmm. as does bringing partners into the ballpark. Our first sponsor in Wrigley was Under Armour, a good Notre Dame partner.
Yep, great.
So Kevin Plank decided to jump in with us and put his logos in the ivy on a couple of our doors, and that was shocking to some of our fans, that mm-hmm. this ballpark would actually adopt the model of having sponsorship mm-hmm. in the ballpark. He's never come off the doors. I don't think he'll ever give them up. They're a great asset for him, and it's helped us build this great relationship with Under Armour, where we now host the Under Armour All-American game at Wrigley. He is the sponsor also for our Performance Center in Arizona, so it's built this great relationship. But our fans don't like change, yet they're starting to see, you know, with video boards comes the ability to see replays. It gives us the ability to relive great moments with Harry Carey and Ernie Banks and Ron Santo, who've all passed away. It's really a chance for them to kind of enhance the experience at Wrigley rather than be bombarded by messages. And certainly we don't tell our fans when to cheer. We don't have, you know, cheerleaders or other things that kind of would be
Make some noise signs,
yeah,
that kind of thing.
Yeah, we don't do any of that. There's no fireworks.
Right.
It's not pyrotechnics. So we've been able to blend it into the character of the ballpark. But it's a conversation, as I said, with our fans that we've been having now, in my case, for 13 years. And they've come along, and they've really understood, largely due to our ownership's commitment to recommit all of our dollars back to winning a championship and saving the ballpark. So if you ask Tom and the family, they'd say, we don't need to take any revenues home. And as a result, our fans understand there is a direct relationship between sponsorship revenue and other things happening in the ballpark and our chances of success. So that's helped. But Wrigley's a special place. It's obviously, it goes back. We're the last ballpark that Jackie Robinson played in. Mm-hmm. It's the site of Babe Ruth's called shot in the World Series. It's the homer in the glove. So there's some great, incredible, deep history about the ballpark. Actually, it's a great trivia answer. The Bears played there for 50 years. So as a standing venue, I think it still holds the title as the longest standing venue for mm-hmm. NFL games. Because most of those ballparks or most of those arenas are taken down after 15, 20 years. So it's great, and its history is it's great. And once modernized, I think it'll also be a great venue for our fans. We're improving our restrooms. We're improving concessions. And then what's going on outside the ballpark is we acquired some property. We're launching a hotel business with our partners at Starwood, 175-room boutique hotel. The office tower, which opens this year, is going to also have retail with Starbucks and other partners. And what we're trying to do is create Town Square for Wrigleyville. The funny thing is I get asked as I walk around the ballpark from fans who are first-timers, hey, this is great, but we've heard about this place, Wrigleyville. Where is it? And as you know, Wrigleyville doesn't exist on a map, right? Mm-hmm. It's a concept. But we're trying to create a place. So when people say, where does it start? We say right here mm-hmm. in our plaza.
Well, this next year, you mentioned some fans who were not as engaged because they won, it's the pressure's off. maybe this is the year to make a lot of good changes because people aren't paying attention as much. So this is the time to do it.
Yeah. You know, we do things incrementally. So even when there's a, you know, we do long-term plans. We do 5 and 10 year plans. And mm-hmm. so there are good ideas that we don't think can be implemented all at once. And so if you really study the ballpark over the last 10 years, the changes have happened every year, but never all at once. And so even sort of the bringing the video boards online and the LED signage, it's kind of happened incrementally so that our fans can get used to it. Because mm-hmm. The one thing we don't want to have happen, and it's important to us, this is a generational asset. So my grandfather took me to my first game at Wrigley. My father was with me, and I'm taking my son. We never want to change that. We want to make sure that when the son brings his son, he can point to the very same elements mm-hmm. that brought his grandfather in. Mm-hmm. So it's and I gotta be honest, Notre Dame has many of the same issues. Mm-hmm. Jack and I talk about it often, mm-hmm. About changing the stadium there. Mm-hmm. There's so much history in that stadium, and video boards are coming. Yeah.
And the same issues with some people don't want it to change. Some people see the benefits of some of the changes. So.
Right. And this younger, you know, the younger fan base who are very connected, mm-hmm. they want to come in and get more information. And so, you know, Jack and I talked a lot about video boards for your football program, and it's a way to convey more information to the fans. Mm-hmm. And I think just like we've done, I know they're going to do it very well.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, thank you so much, and congratulations
thank
again.
You. Pleasure.
Well, you've been watching Mendoza Dialogues. Thank you so much. Crane Kenney, President of Business Operations for the Cubs. Great to have him. If you'd like to learn more about Mendoza or see more episodes of Mendoza Dialogues, you can visit mendoza.nd.edu. Thanks and have a great day.